Bezrat Hashem, next week is Rosh Hashanah. So we're going to learn a little bit about what the Zohar has to say about Rosh Hashanah, where the main mitzvah of Rosh Hashanah, of course, is the blowing of the shofar. We're going to be learning from Parashat Emor. If you want to follow us, this is going to can be found in Parashat Emor in the Zohar, page Tzadikhet 98b, towards the end. And again in Parashat Emor. And being the shofar, the main mitzvah of the holiday, then when the Torah in Parashat Emor is talking about all the festivals, then it's referring to the tkiyah of the shofar. This is the highlight of the day. Bezrat Hashem, we'll learn in the next couple of days, not only from the Zohar, but we're going to learn about the tkiyat shofar, because besides what we need to focus on, the prayer and the tshuva and all the good things that we need to focus on Rosh Hashanah, the highlight of the day is the shofar. And you want to make sure that in the moment when we're blowing the shofar, that you know what to think of, you know what's going on spiritually, you know what is happening in the universe and in the worlds above as the shofar is being blown. And needless to say, to listen to the tkiyat shofar, not to think of other things, definitely not to walk out for a break and so forth. So we want to educate ourselves as much as possible what's so special and what's the significance of the blowing of the shofar. So again, we are in Parashat Emor, page Tzadikhet Amud Bet 98b. The line starts, B'chodesh ha-shevi'i, be'echad l'chodesh, on the seventh month, and the first day of the month, Rabbi Yitzchak Patach. Rabbi Yitzchak, one of the students of Rabbi Shimon, started talking and started to explain this pasuk. Now it says in Tehillim, in the book of Tehillim, chapter Pe'alef, 81, it says, "Tik'u b'chodesh shofar b'kesel leyom chageno." Blow the shofar on this month. And then it says in a very odd way, "Bakesel leyom chageno," in a concealed way on the day of our holiday. So now we need to explain a little bit this idea. First, before explaining the verse, he says a little bit of praises about the nation of Israel. Zakain einun Israel dekutcha brichu, karivlon legabe min kol umin. Happy and lucky are this nation of Israel, that the Kadosh Baruch Hu brought them closer to Him from all the rest of the nation. He gives a very interesting analogy of how the Kadosh Baruch Hu got us close to Him, and he says, "Kemi sheborer geluska yafe mitoch hamrusan." These are terms of the Mishnah, time of the Mishnah, and can also be found in the Talmud. Gluska is the semolina, solet. I think I'm pronouncing it right. Semolina. Semolina, that's how it's called?
Yeah.
So, and mursan is the mixture that they had of the grain when they used to put the grain in water. And then the grain would go a little bit soft and they were able to remove the klipa, the cover, the husk of the grain. So, and that of course would be cleaning the grain and making it much more easier to later on bake and to use it. So it's giving an example, like taking the nation of Israel and removing them from all the nations and bringing them closer to Him. Then he's giving this weird, not weird, but interesting analogy, like removing these klipa, the husk of the grain, when it's a mixture in the water, specifically of the grain of the solet, of semolina. That's the analogy that he gave. But nevertheless, before he explains this verse, he starts with some praises for the nation. And like we said, it says, "Lucky and happy are this nation, ashrihem," this nation that the Kadosh Baruch Hu chose to get them closer to Him. והטעם לסיבת נפשות ישראל החצובות ממקום הקודש. Why specifically it's the souls of the nation of Israel that are carved from a very high holy place, what's specifically the reason for these souls? Why us? And the Kadosh Baruch Hu chose these souls. Of course, the souls of the nation of the Jews, nation of Israel, and he chose them from his will. It's not that somebody came and says, and gave a bribe to Hashem to choose us. That was his will. And this is a will of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. He says, "Miretzono atov," and he chose us before we had merits. Now to say that he's choosing us, okay, we have merits. We don't have much merits. We are holding on the merits of our forefathers. Now, I don't know if you noticed, we started saying Slichot. Well, we started saying Slichot 3 weeks ago. The Ashkenazim, they started saying Slichot yesterday. So today we merged forces. So, but nevertheless, if you're noticing in the text of the Slichot, we're constantly reminding the Kadosh Baruch Hu the merits of Abraham and Yitzchak. Constantly, if you notice how many times. And then, of course, when we get to the part of Anenu, what do we say? Anenu because of Abraham and Yitzchak and Yaakov and David and Shlomo and Eliyahu and Yonah and so forth. We're constantly depending on the merit of our forefathers. But nevertheless, I'm sure we have a few merits here and there. We probably did a few good things in the history, in our past. But nevertheless, now to say that the Kadosh Baruch Hu is choosing for us, okay, so we have already a zchut, we have some type of a merit. But he chose us before we had zchuyot, before we had mitzvot. Obviously, he chose us from his goodwill. He wanted to choose the nation of the Jews. Before, bli hakdamat zchuyotehem shel ma'asim tovim, without them having merits of good actions and good deeds. Ve'en ta'am baratzon, and there's no taste, so to say, or no reason for this will. U'me'atar rechika karivlon legabe, and from a very far away place, meaning for we were mixed between nations of idol worshippers and very far away from the Kadosh Baruch Hu, karav otam elav, he brought them closer, karivlon legabe, he brought them closer to him from a far away place where we were mixed with idol worshippers in Mitzrayim and many others, even before that with Avraham Avinu. Hado dichtiv, as it says in the script, Vayomer Yehoshua el Ha'am. This can be found in the book of Yehoshua, chapter 24. Yehoshua told to the nation, Ko amar Hashem Elokei Yisrael, as the master, the God of Israel, said, Be'ever hanahar yashvu avotechem me'olam. From the other side of the river, your fathers have sat there. And this is referring to Terach, the father of Avraham Avinu. Ve'avi Nachor, ve'yavdu elokim acherim, the father of Avraham Avinu and the father of Nachor, they were idol worshippers, and they used to serve other gods. This verse that we can find in the book of Yehoshua, it comes and it says, Le'achaza deha me'ata rechika, itra'ei behu, ve'karev lon legabe. It comes to show us that we came from a very far away place. We were amongst idol worshippers. And for whatever reason, the Kadosh Baruch Hu chose us and brought us close to him. It also says, Uchtiv, Vaykach et avichem, and I took your father, of course this is referring to Avraham Avinu, et Avraham me'ever anahar, I took Avraham from the other side of the river. That's one of the many reasons why he was called Avraham Ivri, not because he spoke Ivrit, not because he spoke Hebrew, rather because he was Me'ever Lanahari, from there was the other side of the river. Hane Kare Aitle Istakla Behu, in these verses, there's much more what to look upon and what to see, more hidden things. V'chikol Israel La Havu Yadeida, because the entire nation didn't know that. What is something new that Yeshua had to tell us that? I'm sure they had the history books, and I'm sure they learned history in school. Yeshua had to tell them that we all came from Avraham Avinu, and his father was an idol worshiper, and Hashem brought him from the other side of the river. Well, what's the significance of Yeshua saying that again? the nation of Israel didn't know that the Kadosh Baruch Hu took Avraham Avinu and pulled him out from amongst the idol worshippers. V'chol sheken Yoshua, and so much more so Yoshua. Well, Yoshua was the vice president. He was the assistant of Moshe Rabbeinu for 40 years. He didn't know. I'm sure he had a few tips here and there. He knew everything. Im ken, lama yatzich lomar? Ko amar Hashem. If so, so why does the verse have to say, so did Hashem said? And he answers. He presents a question. He also gives an answer. Ela d'orayta kula satim vegalia. The entire Torah is completely concealed and at the same time is also very revealed. Kama dishma kadisha satim vegalia, the same way that the holy name of Hashem, at the same time it's very concealed, meaning much is not known about it, but at the same time it's also very revealed. You can see the letters. You read the letters, Yudke Vavke, you say it's very obvious. Just look at the letters. You don't have to be a genius here. You have four letters here. How many combinations of words can you make from four letters? So you take the Yud and the Hey, and the Vav and the Hey. So you can make one word is Haya. You have two Heys and a Yud. Haya means was. Hove means now, two Heys and a Vav. And Yihye, a Yud and a Hey, and a Yud and a Hey. So this is very galui, this is very obvious. But nevertheless, this is very superficial. You look at the name of Yudke Vavke, ooh, this is very satum, very hidden and many different secrets in there. Shekatuv behavaya v'nikra be'atne. It says, and you know, if you want to look just how concealed it is, if you read it, if you're looking at the letters, it has a Yudke and a Vavke. But we don't read it like that. We just spoke about it this morning. You read it as Aleph Dalet Nun Yud Atne. You don't read it as Yudke Vavke. It's the wrong way to pronounce it, actually. But nevertheless, the same way that Hashem's name in one way is concealed and on the other way is revealed, the same way the Torah. You can read the Torah. Torah can be very transparent to some. But then when you start going deeper and deeper, you see the Torah is not so transparent and the Torah is not so revealed. Begin to write a kula shma kadishahu. Why and how do we say that? Because the entire Torah, every word in the Torah and every letter in the Torah is a part of the holy name of Hashem. Valda ihi satim vegalia. And therefore, it's also concealed and also revealed at the same time. Now he goes back to the same question. V'chozer lekushiya nizkar. I Israel, if the nation of Israel, ve'Yoshua and Yoshua, havo yadei, they knew that Avraham Avinu came from idol worshippers. If so, Amai k'tiv ko amar Hashem. So why did they say in the verse, so said the king of the nation of Israel, meaning like as if it's a direct message coming from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Okay, now he comes and explains that. Ela vadai satima demila. Very, very obvious here that this is a secret behind it and there's something hidden behind what he's saying. Tivu Sagi Avad Kuchabrichu b'Israel. It's a huge chesed, very, very great kindness that the Kadosh Baruch Hu did with the nation of Israel. This in itself we have to realize and thank Hashem constantly for the chesed that he's doing with us, not to take things for granted. Deitra'ei Beru Ba'ahavata, that he chose our forefathers, Dehainu, שהציל את נשמתם ממקום גבוה יותר מנשמות של שם ועבר ושאר צדיקים שהיו לפניהם. We had already צדיקים before Avraham, Yitzchak and Yaakov. We had Adam, we had Shet, we had Shem, we had Ever, we had Noach, we had צדיקים before that. But nevertheless, the Kadosh Baruch Hu chose that the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak and Yaakov, he will bring them down to this world from a much higher place for the other צדיקים originated from. And he made them a chariot, a holy chariot, a supreme or exalted chariot. This is called Merkava Elyona. In Aramaic, it's Reticha Kadisha. This is a very holy chariot. So we know Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and David, the Melech, was the fourth. But there are the chariot. So what does it mean, a chariot? The chariot does what the leader governs. I mean, if the horses are pulling the chariot has no say where it's going. It's just being pulled. completely annulled. The Kadosh Baruch Hu decided to make Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov to be a chariot to him. What does it really mean? This is a more in a more mystical way. Ki ha-gimel avot she-shoresh neshmatam u-bechagat. The three fathers, Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, that the root of their soul is coming from Chesed, Gvura, Tiferet, rooted in the Zeir Anpin. We spoke many times that in the world of Atzilut there are 10 Sfirot, but in each and every one of the Sfirot, there is another 10 Sfirot included in that. So if you're looking at the Sfira of Chesed, in Chesed you can find Chochma bin Adat, Chesed Gvura Tiferet, Netzach Hod Yisod Malchut, in one Sfira, and in each and one of them will be another 10, and then another 10, infinite, and there's always going to be all the Sfirot included in one Sfira. Specifically, the souls of the fathers are coming from Chesed, Gvura, and Tiferet. Avraham is Chesed, Yitzchak is Gvura, and Yaakov is Tiferet. But they're rooted in the Parzuf, in the world. Parzuf is a face, not necessarily a face, but the term of Kabbalah calls it Parzuf. I spoke about it many times. Specifically, in the Parzuf that is called Zeir Anpin, the small face. Hem na'asim merkava el abina. They become a chariot for the Sphira of Bina, meaning that the Sphira of Bina is placed on them. And they are annulled to whatever the Sphira of Bina is giving over or making as a rule, then they just annulled. Vehem kechuta meshulash, and they are compared to a triangled string. Sheleolam lo yinatku ma'akdusha. They are built in a way, the structure of a triangle is a very strong structure. And you see that in our Torah, there are many times this structure of a triangle. Not only talking about the Magen David, that this is one of our symbols, the Star of David. But bichlal, the Torah is called Torah Meshuleshet, Torah that is built from three. And from many places we find that the Torah, there's three aspects of the Torah. You have always the three fathers, we have Kohen Levi Israel. There's so many ways that we look at the Torah and you see that there are three sides to the Torah. But nevertheless, the fathers are built in such a way, like a string that is in a triangle shape, that they will never get disconnected from Kedusha. Ve'apiklon migon har eila yakira kadisha. And in order for them to be merit, to be connected to the Kedusha constantly, hotzi et nishmatam min ha'nahar ha'elyon, Kadosh Baruch Hu took them out from the supreme river, ha'yakar v'kadosh. This is not only that it's supreme, it's very dear and very, very holy. And if you remember, we spoke about this river a few times, because if you remember, a few times we learned in the Zohar classes about the four rivers that go out of Eden. We explained that Eden is the Sphira of Chochmah, and from the Sphira of Chochmah comes out four rivers. And we explained that in depth many times. You can find the classes online. But nevertheless, the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, in order for them to be constantly connected to Kedusha, then the Kadosh Baruch Hu brought them down from this supreme river. And this is the secret of Bina. This is the river that is rooted in the Sphira of Bina. Shederech Yesoda Yitzu Nishmot Shel Avot. From the Sphira of Yesod of Bina, like I just explained, from every Sphira, there's going to be 10 Sphirot included in that Sphira. So from Yesod of Bina came out the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and they manifested, or in a descending chain, they manifested in specifically to the Sphirot of Chesed, Gvura, and Tiferet. Butzina dechol butzinin, and the Bina, being the Maor, the source of shine, HaMaor shel kol haMaorot, Bina is the one that's shining through all the Sphirot. And we explained that also many times in different classes, how Bina is the first Sphira that actually is giving over to the rest of the Sphirot. It's receiving from Chochmah, this He'ara, this shine, but Bina is the one who's going to, so to say, digest it and start delivering it into the Sphirot. So Bina is called HaMaor shel haMaorot, the illuminator of all the illuminators. Why? Ki hi kolelet et kol haSfirot shel Zun kodem l'atzilutam. Bina is what's included in Bina is all the Sefirot of what's called Zun. Zun is an acronym of Zachar v'Nekeva, meaning all the Sefirot from the right and the left side that are placed in the Zeir Anpin. So in Bina is included Chesed Gvura Tiferet Netzach Hod Yisod, before they manifested into their position. Why specifically the Kadosh Baruch Hu decided to take the souls of the forefathers from Bina? Begin the Ita'attar Behu, because he wanted to crown himself with their souls. I know it sounds something that is hard for us to fathom, but when I want to be proud of something, you see it sometimes with parents. They're proud of their kid, so they put on their car, "I'm a proud parent of whatever." You know what I'm talking about, right? Sometimes the parent is proud of the kids, so he says, puts on a sticker on the car, "I'm a proud parent of so-and-so," or you see many times that the parent is proud, "My son is achieved this and that, my son, my daughter achieved this and this." This is in Hebrew it's called Lit'atir, that I crown myself, I adorn myself with the success of my child. So, and sometimes the other way around, of course. But nevertheless, the Kadosh Baruch Hu, he has a lot of geava. He's proud. He says, look at my children, how successful they are. Like a Polish mom. So, no offense here to the Polish nation, of course. But it's just a common joke here that a Polish woman walks in the street with two kids. One is 2 years old, one is 4 years old. Her neighbor runs into her. "Oh, how are you? Who are these little two?" Shall she tell them, "That's Moshe and Chaim"? He says, "Really? How old are they?" So she says, "Moshe, the doctor is 4 and the engineer is 2. So, nevertheless, the Kadosh Baruch Hu adorns himself with the souls of the tzaddikim. So it says, the Kadosh Baruch Hu begin the Ita'atar Behu. Kadosh Baruch Hu wanted to, so to say, adorn himself and to be proud of the success and the greatness of the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, al yedei shiyu kiseh v'merkava eleah, by the fact that the forefathers become the chariot. Chariot is also like a chair. We know that the Kadosh Baruch Hu sitting on the chair of glory, according to the prophecy of Yechezkel, on the chair, one side there's a face of a lion, another side there's a face of an eagle, another side a face of an ox, another side a face of a human. But nevertheless, the base, so to say, of this chair is the neshamot of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov, and David HaMelech. These are the chariots. Hadao dichtiv, as it says, and what we just read, Ko amar Hashem, be'ever anar yeshvu avotachem me'olam. What does the verse say? The verse says, if you're looking at the little part of the verse, it says, your forefathers sat in the other side of the river. Okay, hine, mashikatu, what does it really mean? The river, Hainu, what is this river that it's talking about? It's not talking about the Chidekel, the river that they actually crossed. Rather, Hahu Nahar Dishtmoda Vityada. This is that river that we're referring to, that this is the river coming out of the Sphere of Bina. That they were on the other side of the river, not necessarily because they came out, they crossed the physical river. Hainu Yesod de Bina, talking about the Sphere of Yesod rooted in Bina. That's where the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov came from. Shemisham yetzu neshamot shel avot. From that place, the souls of the fathers came out from. As it says, Me'olam, and he asks, Mai kai bai hacha. What does the script is trying to tell me here? Ilav le'achaza chokhmata. Not to show us here the something so simple, rather to show us the greatness and the wisdom and the secrets of the Torah. And why? How do we see that? Because it says, Me'ever anahar me'olam. On the other side of the river, me'olam means before. And he explains now, what's the secret behind it? You have to look at the secret. The Zohar is coming to explain more deeper level than just the pshat. Ela hahu nahar olam ikre. This river is called Olam, a world. Why? Ela ze anahar shu yesod de bina nikra b'shem Olam. This river is called Olam, a world, because it's coming from the Sfira of Yesod, rooted in Bina. ועל כן מעולם פירשו כמו מעבר הנהר. That's why it's explained מעולם. This is the other side of the river. ועל דה, and therefore כתוב בעבר הנהר. That's why it says on the other side of the river. What is the other side of the river? This is the Yesod, the sphere of Yesod, rooted in the sphere of Bina, that he calls it Ima. Yashvu avotechem me'olam, your forefathers have sat there before that, preceded that. Sham yashvu neshamot avot, that's where the souls of Avraham, Yitzchak, and Yaakov were sitting there. Misham yardu v'nishtarshu b'chagat. From that they came down into the world. Before they manifested into the world, they entered into the worlds of Chesed, entered into the spherot of Chesed, Gevurah, and Tiferet. Why? Le'achaza'a, to show to you, shetitbonen v'titen shevach v'ad al Kadosh Baruch Hu, that you look and you should constantly praise and thank the Kadosh Baruch Hu. On what? Tivu ukshot da'avad kutshabrichu l'Israel. The great Chesed and the emet, the truth, that the Kadosh Baruch Hu did to the nation of Israel. But how? By the fact that he took the souls of the forefather from such a high place, and that's where they were rooted. And since they were rooted in such a high place, we are rooted from them. After all, they're not for nothing called our fathers. We are rooted from them. Yitzchak came from Abraham, Yaakov came from Yitzchak, and from Yaakov came 12 Shvatim, and we're all from these 12 tribes. Meaning that we are also rooted, if you backtracking where we come from, then we come also from the Yesod of Bina. And nevertheless, all that is why? So we can constantly go back to where we came from and see the great chesed, the great kindness that Hashem did to us, and constantly be in a form of thanking and acknowledging the great chesed. I don't know many people that they wake up in the morning and when they say Modei Ani, they say, wow, Baruch Hashem, Baruch Hashem, I'm Jewish. So our sages decided, since you don't do that every morning, so they added that as one of the brachot. Baruch Atah Hashem, Elokeinu Melech Haolam, Shelo Asa Ani Goy. So this is not a derogatory blessing. It's the contrary. It's I'm thanking the Galon, Hashem, Baruch Hashem, that you made me a Jew, that you made me from the nation of Israel. It's not a negative thing, rather it's a positive thing. Now he continues and he says, Va'ekach et avichem, and then I took your father, et Avraham, your father Avraham, me'ever anahar, from the other side of the river. This is what the verse says. But he says, he asks a question here. Mai kai mairi. What comes the script to tell me here? I know where you took Avraham from. I remember the history. I remember also the geography. Why do you, the script has to tell me that you took Avraham from the other side of the river? And he answers, Ela Avraham, Avraham, that he's rooted in the sphere of Chesed, specifically in the Zir Anpin, She'ala b'chokhma she'bekav ha'yamin. Avraham Avinu went up to the sphere of Chokhma, specifically rooted in the Kav Yamin, in the right side. We explained many times that the Sfirot are divided into the right side, the left side, and the middle side. Avraham Avinu went up into the right side, and this is the, because we know that Avraham is rooted in Chesed. What is above Chesed, if you look at the structure of the Sfirot, is Chokhma. So Avraham went up to the sphere of Chokhma. La itzdabka be'ahu nahar, and he wasn't attached to that river that we're referring to, that this is the sphere of Bina. Why? Because Bina is on the left side. This is the head of the Kavasmol, the left side. So, and who's coming from the left side? This is Yitzchak. So Avraham Avinu did not get attached to the river, rather he went up to the Kaveh Yamin, to the right side, into Chochmah. Yitzchak, on the other hand, he's rooted from Gvura. Gvura is placed under Bina, he's from the left side. Yitzchak, we know, Yitzchak is the secret of Gvura, of the Ziran Bin, and Yitzchak is the one who went up in the left side to the sphere of Bina. They tedabk be besitra leit kafa, and he got stuck, so to say, in the side of Gvura. And Gvura is rooted in Bina. Leitchazik betokfo, in order to become stronger in his severity. And he sends us here to a reference to a much more in-depth explanation. Specifically, that can be found in the Shara Kavanot of the Arizal, Dushchet, if you want to go and open it, you look into Shara Kavanot. This is the scripts of the Arigizal. And he says there in page 8, specifically in Drush 8, sorry, page Tzadik Chet, there's a much more explanation. What does it mean? Why specifically Yitzchak, coming from the side of Gvura, how is he connected to the Shofar? After all, you remember that at the time of the Akedah, then Avraham Avinu, he grabbed the ram and he slaughtered the ram instead, and he took the Shofar, and that's the Shofar that was blown at Matan Torah. The other horn, this is the Shofar that Mashiach is going to blow very soon. So there is a strong connection specifically with Yitzchak and the Shofar, but nevertheless, we're not going to stop on this right now. We're just going to finish this part of the Zohar. The rest will continue tomorrow with a very, very in-depth explanation of what the Rizal says in Shara Kavanot, specifically on that we can have a little introduction to understand everything that we want to learn about the Shofar and Rosh Hashanah. Now he just continues, just one more paragraph and we're done. Tachazi, come and look. Hayan nahar afal gav delav ihudina. Come and look, this nahar, even though this river is referring to the sphere of Bina, nevertheless, Bina is, so to say, on the, above Gvura. Gvura is din, is a judgment. Nevertheless, this river is not din. This is not a river of judgment. Why? Ki lemala begimel rishonot, because above the sefirot, gimel rishonot is referring to Chochma, Bina, and Dat. It's based on Nari. The Ramak says that the gimel rishonot is Keter, Chochma, and Bina. But nevertheless, gimel rishonot is the gimel, means three rishonot, the first ones. And he says there, gimel rishonot en achizat adinim. There's no dinim. There's no any achiza, any grab of dinim in the mochin. So nevertheless, then Bina cannot be coming from a side of din. Hagam shabina ushor shadinim. Even though Bina is the root of dinim, dinim are judgments. Aval sham kol adinim hem mebusamim hem umetakim. The dinim, where they're placed in Bina, they're actually sweet there. This is a concept we talked about it a couple of times, that it's called hamtakat dinim, sweetening the dinim. The din, you can remove the din. Din is actually a very good thing, but we want to sweeten the dinim. So there's many ways how to sweeten the dinim. Nevertheless, when it's placed in the source, in Bina, then the dinim already are sweetened over there. There's nothing negative there. With all that, aval, im kol zot, dinin nafke misitra dit kafube, the dinim are coming from the side of Bina. Hainu, me'atvuna, it's coming from the side of Dvina, but uveridatam bigvoa dezeiran pin, sham mitchazkim bo betokef. Once the dinim go down from Bina into Gvura, that's when the dinim become severe, that's when they become strong, then it's already transforming, so to say, to not such a positive thing. Only if it's too much. If it's too much, then the dinim will be negative. But if it's not, then there's nothing wrong with dinim. Dinim is something very good, severity and judgment. V'chad Yitzchak ittakaf bedinoi. And when Yitzchak comes from the midata din, Yitzchak is rooted in the sphere of Gvura, mitchazek bedinav berosh Hashanah. Yitzchak, coming from the side of Gvura, and we mentioned, we'll talk about it tomorrow, Bezrat Hashem, what Ari is going to explain, why Yitzchak, what's the connection of Yitzchak specifically to the Shofar, but nevertheless, it says Yitzchak is midata din, it becomes stronger and stronger in the dinim, when? Only in Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah is the time of itgabrut dinim, too much dinim. Kedein ilayin v'tatein mitkanfei ledina. As then, what happens is, the supreme, the exalted, and the lower ones, mitasfim ledin. All the sefirot are gathering together to empower the dinim, the judgments. V'chur saya dedina itakan, and the chair, so to say, this is a metaphorical way of curse, but for the chair of the din, that the din sits on it, shu ziran pin u'amalchut. Now the ziran pin and the malchut becomes the chair where all the dinim are sitting on. Nitaken, it's sitting there and it's placed there. U'malka kadisha yati val kursa de dina vedai alma. And the holy king, which is referring to the sphere of Bina, yoshev al kisei adin vedan et ha'olam. That's when the Kadosh Baruch Hu takes the chair of judgment and he sits on it and starts judging the entire world. This is by Rosh Hashanah. It's called Yom Hadin, the Day of Judgment. This is when the whole world is trembling. For us, it's just another day. We're dipping some apples in honey. We think, business as usual. We don't know that right now the Kadosh Baruch Hu and the entire heavenly realm is tilted and completely empowered by dinim. This is the day that we have to sweeten the dinim. That's one of the many reasons why we dip the honey in the apple. The Arizal explains that specifically, we'll talk about it in Rosh Hashanah, specifically the Arizal explains, if you went to his shul lately, look at the shul, it says on the top, Chakal Tapuchin Kadishin, Orchard of Holy Apples. This Orchard of Holy Apples is a very deep teachings of Kabbalah, but when we take the physical apple and we dip it into honey, we're actually sweetening all the dinim in the world above. Something so simple, but nevertheless, with the right kavanah, we're able to sweetening the judgments. Bechlal, we know that on Rosh Hashanah, it's highly recommended at every free moment that you have, you don't sit and you play blackjack. Rosh Hashanah, you read Tehillim. Tehillim has the ability to sweeten the judgments, and you want to every free moment on Rosh Hashanah, 48 hours, just to read Tehillim, constantly just to reduce the judgments. We already spoke yesterday, one of the many ways what the Zohar teaches us, what to do on Rosh Hashanah to reduce the dinim. And we spoke about it yesterday, you can see the classes already online. But in short words, it just said that a person that gives over their ego and completely forgives and forgets and lets go, then that's when he's protected at the time of Rosh Hashanah from judgments. Usually we go into Rosh Hashanah and that person I'm upset at because he said something about me, and that person I'm not happy about because he said something about my wife, and that person looked at me the wrong way, and this person did this to me, and we're coming into Rosh Hashanah with a lot of anger and hatred and bad feelings about other people. The more you let go, that's where you kind of going under the cover of the protection not to be so affected from the dinim. But nevertheless, on the day of Rosh Hashanah, the dinim, the judgments of Yitzchak, they get so powerful that it manifests all the way down to the Sefirah of Malchut, and the entire heavenly realm becomes a chair for the Kadosh Baruch Hu to sit on, and it's a chair of judgment. And that's if the dinim are way too strong, then this is not good. This is not good when the dinim are way too strong. Dinim means judgment. So we said that the Kadosh Baruch Hu sits on the chair of judgment, Kedain, as it says, Tiku b'chol shofar b'kesel yom chagenu. This is the verse that we just read from the book of Tehillim that we want to interpret. What does it mean? Blow and in this month from the shofar b'kesel yom chagenu, in a concealed to the day of our holiday. Ke'al yedei ha-shofar nimtakim adinim. By blowing the shofar, we are sweetening the dinim. ומתעוררים הרחמים, and we are starting to arouse mercy. וישראל יוצאים זכאים כדמפרש ועזל. And the nation of Israel, they go out, they get acquitted, or they become zakai. Zakai means they win the judgment. Zakain, what does it mean that they become, they get acquitted? Inun Israel deyadin lesalka kusa dedina. Happy is the nation of Israel that they know how to remove, so to say, the chair of judgment. Uletakana kursa derchame. And to say to Hashem, why are you sitting on this old chair of judgment? Here we just created for you a beautiful chair of mercy. Why don't you park yourself in this beautiful baby? It can be yours for only $9.99 in three simple payments. Come and sit on the chair of rachamim. And of course he's asking, of course I'm joking, Don't take me so serious. But nevertheless, it says that we able to letaken, to create a chair of mercy. And now he asks, how do we do such a thing? How do we deliver that lazy boy for the Kadosh Baruch Hu to sit on this chair of mercy? How? Osim ze b'shofar. How do we do it? With the shofar. Shofar is the mitzvah that transforms the judgments into mercy. Mezad Hashem, tomorrow we'll see what the Arizal says, specifically in the gates of Kavanot, Shara Kavanot, where he explains the root of the shofar and a little bit more of a deeper Kabbalistic meaning to that. Mezad Hashem will do that, and then the rest of the days We'll continue with the Zohar. What specifically is the power of the Shofar, and why is the Shofar the part, the source that sweetens the judgments? And of course, how has that got to do with me? Because in 1 week I'm going to be sitting here, and there's going to be the moment when we blow the Shofar. Now what? Besides just listening. Okay, now I'm listening to the Shofar. What do I need to do? So we want to know what to prepare, how to be ready, that when there's that short moment from 48 hours, the blowing of the Shofar takes 5 minutes. So we should be prepared in the right way. Why? Because this is the moment when we sweep the judgments into mercy, and that's where we merit to be blessed with Shana Tova, the Gemar Chatima Tova, with a sweet year, with a happy year, a year of health, a year of wealth, a year of sustenance and parnasa, and everything that we need. And Bezat Hashem, we should continue tomorrow, and the rest should follow in the rest of the days. And Bezat Hashem, we should merit to not even get to Rosh Hashanah and be judged by Dinim. Rather, we should have Mashiach already way before that, so we can be judged by Melech HaMashiach only with chesed and kindness. רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות את ישראל, לפיכך הרבה להם תורה ומצוות, שנאמר, אדוני חפץ למען צדקו, יגדיל תורה ויעדיר.